from the page. Other talks are useful for me, maybe not as much as my work is. So start from four-dimensional arrays. Look for at least for the scale that H is not at least zero only. The examples I'll speak about that they are of this kind of cohomology department. So there's cohomology here. And usually say for robotic examples.
Sure.
Lecture of the school by Christian, we know that there are some birational what was noticed about the 20 years ago, maybe before, but people didn't hear another thing, that sometimes these two spaces, they know a little bit about each other. So H even knows some information about the most basic. See the curve. And we used to think that curve has this main birational environment, it's discrete environment as G. So G is something that relates to the first cohomology. But in practice, you can also derive it from even cohomology if you take into account the interval structure. So H, what was the Hodge diagram? Hodge diagram. Looks like some G and G. So odd cohomology is 2G dimensional space. Even cohomology is always two-dimensional space and just it has some basis. And there's a Poincaré pairing and that's just unimodular pairing for signature 1, 1, 2, 3. Zero, and it looks the same for all the curves, right? Now let's look from slightly different perspective. We place the homology discrete circle. There are two of them, K0, K1, and they're related to even and odd homology. Maps that do not preserve the integral structure, right? They come after integral classes, rational classes, If multiplied by Q, then this isomorphism is just Q vector spaces. They are the same, but they have different integral structures. Probably Nick will tell more about this in his slides. Apart from this integral structure, there's a different pair here. So this thing has usually for an algebraic geometry, one can consider not only k0 topological or k1 topological, but also algebraic counterparts. They are not periodic, but still there's k0 algebraic. Have an k0 topological, just forgetting about algebraic structure. And we have some image of this in here, but what else because it won't be really matter. So if you look for k0 algebraic of the curves, that it contains already both information. It knows the topological K-theory, and also it has the primitive, the Picard, the Picard variety of my curve, at least it's a part of this data. But I want to say that if we look for this genus of the curve, then we can see it even from topological K-theory. Right, so on K0 algebraic, there is an Euler pairing. It's related with such a small part, so that it's defined by chi as some minus I. Two objects, say, in the right of X, then to these two objects I can associate a collection of finite dimensional vector spaces. There are only finite domain of them, and their alternating sum is invariant. It depends only on their classes and on the KT. So this depends on classes. Triangulated category, we can consider the growth in this group, just given by all the objects up to prime. So, and this is the bilinear pairing, so bilinear. But usually it is not symmetric and not skew symmetric, right? So it's symmetric for if dimension of X is given, and X is Calabi-Yau, and skew symmetric. X is Calabi-Yau. But if X is not Calabi-Yau, it is usually not symmetric. Right? One can define the same thing topologically. Just we have the X and point, of course, projection pi, then I have the push forward from topological K0. Logical K0 of a point, which is Z, and then I can define chi of P F chi star of U times F. Yeah, so I have the map E goes to U, which has some involution, but it's not a part of the data of the record. So it doesn't know what's the involution. Anyway, I have this involution. Just to vector bundle, I associate with dual vector bundle and then continue to take it. And then this way I have this bilinear pair. And so let's look for the take a basis. Okay. Basis of the curve and look for Brown matrix. Brown matrix. Basis, maybe look. It depends actually on what is my curve, right? So, say if I work over some some field. Then basis is given by the structure shift. I always have the structure shift of my curve, that's an element. And then sometimes my curve may have no point or may have no divisor of degree 1, but have divisor of some degree z. So let's look for A such that degree of A is more than 0 and minimal. Line bundle of minimal positive degree, that's defined by our method. Then just this number can be easily computed by Riemann-Roch formula. And okay. So I look for homomorphism from O to O. That's just Euler characteristic of O, that's dot genus, which is 1 minus g. Right. Should I have 1 minus g here? D plus 1 minus g. So this is the ground matrix. It doesn't really depend on the basis. I mean, it behaves like a bilinear form. If I change the basis, you know, accordingly, I should change the matrix. And if I look for this matrix, then what could I tell? That my M, because usually if I have non-symmetric and non-skew symmetric matrix, I can decompose it into two parts, symmetric and skew symmetric. That's symmetric plus M skew symmetric. Take sum, half of the sum, and half of the difference. Then what is the symmetric part? So M symmetric equals to 1 minus G times 1. And M skew equals to D times 0, 1 minus 1, 0. And what basically we see from this, so this are the invariants. So what invariants we see from here? So first is the sign of signature of M symmetric. Then I have number, suppose M is the ideals such that maximal N such that M symmetric equals to 0 mod N. And I have also D, the same for the M skew symmetric. Maximal N such that N skew equals to 0 mod N. These are three invariants of the curve that I got just from the even cohomology from K0. I have not used K1. So even cohomology, if I take into account the integral structure and some data of this circumference, it knows the genus, right? So this equals to 1 minus G. Up to sine, and the sine I can determine from here. So if it's genus 0 curve, n-symmetric is... it's kind of negative, non-positive. If it's genus 1 curve, n-symmetric is just 0. Then it's more interesting. Then if it's more than 1, then n-symmetric is not... if it's 0, it's non-negative, but it's more than 1, it's non-positive. Right, so... just what I was saying, that genus of the curve you can also get just from the numerical data of even cohomology if you look for KT instead of cohomology. And that's some kind of one of the motivation that, so some expectation, there's some there should be some birational invariants. From this numerical data, that's just lattice, some pairings, and so now let's look for finite threefold of prime series. I forgot whether it's called prime series. Let's say x equals such that x equals h and minus ax equals r times h. So r is usually called null index. Index and it is null to and define another environment called level. That's some ad hoc definitions. An index is a old definition, level is more recent. It's R times half times H cube. One interesting thing about that, that I have two in the denominator, but level is always integral. If the degree is odd, then index is even. Yeah. If index is odd, then degree should be even. So that's the level, and now define I of x as the following: r times psi of n, psi is Dedekind's psi function. Just given by this formula, so z of f and z of x minus 1. If I take this directly serious, then it's coefficients, it's the different psi function, or just can write more like psi of n is n times product e times n. Maybe this one is most useful for computations, and this is more related to some iteration behind.
So what was gamma?
R.
Huh? Well, that's R.
Gamma zero of n is just modular group.
No, no, so I of x was gamma times psi of n.
What?
One kind of board up. The board above?
Yeah, I of x. That's R, sorry.
R.
That's R of x. Look, this number, funny index. Right. So multiply index by psi function of level. So there should exist, there is some definition of a rational of trifolds, or maybe of some trifolds of particular kinds, rationally connected. Such that it takes this value I of x on x on this x. So what does it basically say? This is what might be useful, that there's some classification of this Fano trifolds, it's required number one, so there's this Fano is cost classification, Fano is cost classification. It's the card number one. So let's say there are 17 deformation. If index is 4, then it's T3, projective space, because index 4, that's the unique one. Similarly, if index is 3, cubic. So let's compute this environment for this simple.
Quadric.
Huh? Quadric, yeah, quadric. So what is the index of P3? So R equals to 4, and what is the M? M equals to 4 times 2 times H cube. And H cube equals to 1, it's just a hyperplane thing here. So times 1, so that's 2. And for quadric, R equals to 3, and M equals to 3 divided by 2 times, now this degree of the quadric, since it's a quadric, H cube, it's a hyperplane section, cube is 2, so it's 12 is 3. So if R equals to 2, then it implies that H cube belongs to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's what it's right. B, N. And for example, B3 is a cube of 3. So B3 cube of 3. B4 is intersection of the vortex. Variety, variety defined of how you can decompose a quadratic equation and the sum of these values. And for example, B2 is also this variety that was discussed today, that's worth it, number 30. B2, maps to B3, B1 branches. And B1 is even more complicated. That's also something. B1, B2, B1, 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 B1,
class for there's some easy cases. So like if you take hyperplane section of this surface, then you get the Bezier surface, and you get the next hyperplane section, it's an elliptic curve. And most complicated cases are equals to 1, and then n belongs to the list of those numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, or that's the case where the hyperplane section is K3 surface, and the next hyperplane section is canonically embedded curve. Okay. This are the numbers, and if you try to construct this invariant psi, then I. What does it equal to? So here I equals to 4 times psi of 2. Psi of 2 is 3, so it's about here I equals to 3 times psi of 3. Psi of 3 is 4, so it's 12. Let's look maybe 4. That's basically the table of the values of I for 1 and 3 equals. I don't put n equals to 1, n equals to 1 is a little bit different. And what we see, for example, where is the 12? Here.
Sorry, what did you write? What did you write?
Here I put number n.
Then the number you compute for the
This psi of n, 2 psi of n, 3 psi of n, 4 psi of n. And I computed only for those cases where there exists N and F for a family. So that's kind of Golosha's Mendeleev table of family. Golosha. The table can be actually extended to some other values of n, but because it's more than one, but one over some non-algebraically closed fields, and more n's. You can relate in some way the finite triples to conjugates of classes of Matyoglu, but it's not here, and it was the relation, it's one of the original relations for this environment. So what we see here, for example, so there are a couple of theorems. It looks like almost everything is known about the rationality. This is maybe not about stable rationality, others like union rationality. But rationality is kind of well studied, at least for every known results. People long before the definition, predating this definition, of course. So if I equals 12, n equals to 3 intersection of quadric and the cubic, if it's known for all of them, then they're irrational. For general, it's known. There are some other coincidences. You can see, for example, we have 8 here and here, and 6 here and here. Right? So there's some work about double projection. That's the example that was discussed here. So this is the cubic threefold, right? And you have a cubic threefold, and you have the look for Grassmannian 2-6. So Grassmannian 2-6 inside P14, and its projective dual is 5 and 4-6. And And in this case,
what's the phi phen variety? It's a cubic hypersurface given by equation phi phen of skew symmetric 6 times 6 matrix equals to 0.
And this plot, what you can do to each other, so here we consider this variety V14. Usually the notation is when it's index 1, so V2n.
That's usually how they are called. In index 1, level 7, variety of index.
So consider this Grassmannian intersected. Something of co-dimension 5, this one index 7, intersected 9. P of W, co-dimension equals to 5, and y double, and here x double is this 5 and intersected with the annihilator of W, something of dimension 5.
So this is a cubic threefold, and this is the variety of V14.
I can tell the explicit descriptions of all those varieties, but they does not look very similar to each other. But
when the degree is small, what do you know about this specification?
On one hand, when degree is small, these are something like complete intersections. When degree is big, the description is complicated. But if we look for problems of rationality, it's other way around. This variety is complicated description, they tend to be rational, and those that are close to complete intersections, very hard to tell anything about their rationality, just the complicated problems that we talked about. But the descriptions are not uniform. This table can be more
uniform. There should be something behind this classification. And if you look for those intersection of Grassmannian and intersection of Pfeiffer, then the result of basic Kuznetsov says that there are different categories for x double. So, for the double, u of y double, b, or something. W, and what we know from before from FAN, that FW and PW are birational to each other. So XW, they modulate spaces, but not much. Like there are, for one cubic, there are different ways how you can express it as a Pfeiffer. There's a five-dimensional space of all expressions of a cubic as a Pfeiffer, and cubics have 10-dimensional moduli, and this have 15-dimensional moduli. So in particular, some YWs are known to be birational to each other. But still, we see that sometimes it happens that varieties from this deformation class are birational to varieties from this deformation class. So, if this happens, and if you have an invariant that deformation doesn't depend on the deformations, obviously it should coincide. So, this class is this kind of class. And similarly, for example, if you look for those cases, there's varieties V22 that have six-dimensional moduli, this one is rigid, and there's some classical construction, this double projection from a line that projects this one guy to this one, they are both birational and actually rational. Intersection of two quadrics also rational, as well as V18, and you can relate this intersection of two quadrics and V18, that's a projective duality for G2 Grassmannian. So case M4 is projective duality for cases when n is small is more complicated, there are some non-commutative things appearing, but still, or something like that. Maybe the main message is, at least if you don't know the classification, you want to know approximately who should be the rational to whom, just draw this table and you see this compute IFX. It's a mnemonic rule, at least that's useful. And the problem is how to make any sense of it. And in the remaining time, I can take some motivation with the definition of how to do it. And maybe how to approach that. What could be the hints given?
x is say finite interval.
Then you can look for so-called mirror symmetry for at least the card number one. This card. Mm-hmm. Mirror symmetry says that to this thing as a symplectic manifold, that does two things. There's a mirror family, so family of KT surfaces, or that's not only for trifolds in all dimensions. X. And then it says that the right category of coherent systems corresponds to category of vanishing Lagrangian cycles. In particular, if you look for zero, the topological flux corresponds to some intermediate homology. And also inside X, look for Z. Inside X, the anti-canonical hypersurface, right? So that's also K3. This card equals to Z, usually this card. And then you can speak about mirror dualities between those K3 surfaces and this K3 surface. These are, have one dimensional complex moduli, this one dimensional simplex. Now you can look for values similarly, like the right category of coherent sheets on the Z should correspond to Foucault categories, those fibers. And now, what are the auto equivalences basically that we'll get again to Kantsevich? So, auto equivalences. Of this direct category of coherent sheets on Z, they correspond to monodromy of this family. Monodromy. There's also some work in the area. If you have found a trifold with Picard number Z, then the monodromy group you can describe quite explicitly. So here you have K3 surfaces with Picard number 19. So transcendental cycles are three-dimensional. So Ts is isomorphic to Z3. So generic transcendental cycles is a three-dimensional lattice with a pairing, of course, right? It has a symmetric pairing of signature. Okay. Signature to one. The monodromy, of course, preserves this pairing. Right? So you have the orthogonal group, of U, and you have the monodromy group inside this orthogonal group. So this invariant Fx is basically the index of one inside that. There's a more explicit construction how you can do this, such as P1 is identified with moduli space of isogenous E to P prime, and to one isogeny. Moduli space of elliptic curves with an isogeny up to so called free convolution. If you have E to E prime, you have the dual thing from P prime to E, and you identify them.
So, what is the reference for this equality that you recommend the index of X as the index of the monodromy group?
Yeah. So, you can see this on the mirror side, it's basically the index of one.
I'm just asking for a reference for that.
I'm not sure, it's maybe written, but work of Golishev somehow. Yeah. There's some,
The initial index made by the work of Dolgachev on so-called mirror symmetry for K3 surfaces, for lattice polarized K3. Basically what it says there, that if you look for those families of K3s with algebraic cycles given by minus EA plus minus EA plus U 0, 1, 1, 0 plus 2, n. Then this is this this curve, and over this curve you have universal elliptic curve E, universal elliptic curve E prime. You consider the product, look for Kummer surface, and then you do the show the inner sink. And this way you clearly see that what should be the monodromy of your this family is modular. So monodromy of this modular family is this modular group that you started from, and here this group related to gamma 0 of n plus. Gamma 0 of n, and that's the frequent dilution. And just group the equation by here, the model of the index of gamma 0 of n inside SL to Z, that's exactly what I wrote. And here, you map SL to Z, it's something like a symmetric square. Like if you take symmetric square of two dimensional representation, that's three dimensional, it's the same, but slightly twisted. Yeah, so on this side, it's kind of the index of the monitoring group here. Then, if you forget about me, not forget, now you transfer it to here, and then you see what this monodromy transformations. For example, if you have some here, you always have some fiber, for example, over some point C, the most right point with the biggest absolute and real eigenvalue, and there you have a fiber with ordinary double points, so ordinary double point. We draw one dimensional picture, but it's two dimensional. So this ordinary double points, they correspond to exceptional objects in your Banner Diffels direct category, or the spherical objects in your K3 direct category. And if you have spherical objects, spherical, exceptional. Consider so-called Lagrangian symbols. So if I have the critical point and I pass on the base, then I have the vanishing cycle from this point of Lagrangian vanishing cycle. Its class depends on what the homotopy type of the path is. But so they correspond to exceptional objects on in the direct category of my planner. For example, if I choose and just go from plus infinity over the real positive line until I get the first critical point, it will be ordinary double point, and that's what corresponds to structure shift. If I restrict them to my K3, they correspond to spherical objects in the right category of Z. And if you have exceptional objects on exceptional collections, if you have an exceptional object, you have some semi-orthogonal decomposition. If you have on the set of decomposition, there's notion of mutations that Sasha explained in the lectures. And spherical objects are in some sense much better because this mutations, it's not a functor, it's just some operation between different decompositions. And spherical objects, it gives you the spherical twists, spherical twists. P representation S P, then I have T S P. That gives you an auto equivalence. So that's auto equivalence. And for example, if I consider this particular path, then I have structure. It corresponds to structure shift there, and I have this twist with respect to the structure shift on K3 surface and K3 surface structure shift. Thank you. set of technologies, like two-dimensional sphere. And I have many others. And then, like here for each critical point, I have Picard-Lefschetz theorem that says me that the monodromy around this fiber is on the level of the Picard-Lefschetz on our side vibration. It says me if I have a critical point, what's the monodromy around this critical point, right? This, if I look for its section on cohomology, it's reflection with respect to, in this case, it's orthogonal reflection with respect to the class of the vanishing cycle. So I have vanishing cycle, that's, let's say, the sphere. So monodromy around P is reflection with respect to class of A. And what this element corresponds on the other side, it should correspond to the spherical twist acting here, or just on the level, again, forgetting about the derived category, induces reduction on the KT, just a reflection in the lattice. You have some isomorphism between those two lattices. KT, the image of the K0 of X, K0 of Z, and topological. And you can look for image of this thing here, and this will be three-dimensional lattice. K0 of X is four-dimensional, but this map has a kernel, structure shape of point, it's a kernel. And this image of phi, image of phi, it corresponds to transcendental cycles of the cycles here. So you just forgetting about mirror symmetry, you're just starting from X. In principle, you can construct this local system just looking for algebraic cycles on X and also for some extra data, the quantum cohomology, how the type the for various rational curves that pass. Or looking at the just if you know the decomposition, say if you have some exceptional collection, then just you explicitly can construct this spherical objects in the derived category, the roots in this lattice, and look for reflections with respect to these roots. If you want topological, you can just place them there. So this invariant I of X is related to the index of the monodromy group here. And just what will be very nice is just to forget about the right-hand side and just look for maybe this particular lattice, maybe either topological K0 theory of X, or say what should be its image in the anti-canonical surface if it would exist. It's something that you can in principle do virtually. Just the pairing on Z is the symmetrization of the pairing on X. Symmetric or non-skew symmetric, but if you symmetrize it, you will get what should be the pairing of this Z, even if you don't have this Z. So somehow real definition of could look. Be the maybe index of some particular subgroup in orthogonal group on K0 algebraic of X modulo kernel. Generated by.
Sorry, the module of what?
Module of the kernel. I put algebraic. If you look in the image of topological, just image of this in topological KT. Right? Mm-hmm. So that's the lattice, and there's the parent, and I have the group of orthogonal transformations, and inside this group I want to consider some subgroup and look for its index, generated by what should be.
So we're taking the orthogonal group of the symmetrization.
Yes, symmetrization is actually a big problem because, like, when you have some orthogonal decomposition, you control nicely what happens, and when you symmetrize it, you lose this control. That's one way. The other way, like, when you look a little bit, gamma zero of n is some group related to congruences, right? It's matrices that equals to upper triangular modulo m. So. Main problem is like,
sorry,
you want to do a rational event, something that does not change when you blow up a point and the curve. Right? So far I spoke only about Picard number one, and there's like more complicated story how this mirror symmetry changes when you do, like when you increase Picard number. You have the more higher dimensional base, essentially, and it's worst control problems. Here you have more, when you blow up something, you have more simplistic moduli, and on the other side you have more complex moduli, and just your like family here is kind of degeneration, like some locus of the the limit of the two-dimensional family when you go to center. Still, there's, I mean, I have some hope that it might work, it might not, just to say if. For dimension more than, yeah.
Sorry, I don't understand. What is the link between the two definitions of I of x?
Two definitions of what?
Of I of x? When you
define
it using the...
There's an ad hoc definition, I said, just for... If you have found a triple with Picard number one, consider this number. And I expect that there's some good definition of some rational environment. So there's the definition plus the proof that it's invariant after the blocks. Such that it takes this way. It's a very strong statement, right? If you can do it, it just proves many theorems that were known by case-by-case analysis before. Yeah? And also, we don't know what's some... Not everything we still know, I think, but we don't even know for this intersection of quadratic and cubic, there is a rational. Generic is irrational, but this Enriquez problem, whether limit of irrational, it can be rational in dimension 3, it still holds open to this, you know, if you have this smooth family. But just, it's not a coincidence, but how to work out the good definition is just. Maybe it should be better to tell yesterday on the problem session. Yeah, so, yes, thank you. Maybe one can work out for triples, then you can do this for fourfolds, because there's more like expectation for fourfolds that algebraic cycles control this. And this thing knows very well what's the algebraic cycles, right? We have the image of algebraic KT in topological KT. I skip the case of the surfaces. For surfaces, you can also do some irrational invariants, especially for non-closed fields that take into account this. You can distinguish, say, cubic surface. There's a theorem of Iskovsky. If you have cubic surface with Picard number one, then it's non-rational. This way you can also summarize.
The
surface
that the experimental evidence is that for the known rationality or irrationality statements,
yeah,
they are controlled by this number I of x for the Fanon trifold.
Yeah.
This is a proved statement, or?
Yeah, like all the known examples about all the known theorems of rationality and irrationality, they
depend only on the I of x.
Yeah, they might match it. If there will be, say, counterexample to Enriquez problem, right, and it will, you need to say maybe rationality of generic one and the family. And of course, mirror symmetry says about generic one, but what I say, like if you look for fourfolds, then you have some question about what are the Hodge cycles, how many algebraic cycles are there, and this thing, it can control it, so you can make an invariant that depends on your particular type of the Hodge cycles, because the slightest is just, you look for, here I look for even plus, they all are Hodge, algebraic, and so on, you can look for some particular, and then distinguish them between.
So this the index of that, you haven't told us what's the subgroup.
Generated by lots of spherical twists. That's the problem. You can just look for all elements, say, of degree of length 2 and generate the group by them, but that's a good definition.
But, and you've checked that this agrees with your psi function? in some cases?
Yeah, that's the motivation kind of behind that. Yeah, that's the psi function. At least that's the index of the monodromy of the mirror. And the monodromy of the mirror corresponds to this spherical twist, like more complicated twist.
Right.
If you have more complicated singular fiber.
Right.
Or you can look for spherical twists and, say, multiplication by line bundles. What you have the typical auto-equivalence is the trivial ones, multiplication by line bundles, shifts, automorphism that you have to find and spherical twists.
That somehow the subgroup with that orthogonal group generated by automorphisms of
yeah.
But it's really checked for those final three points that these numbers are the same, or that or there's just this
I checked on this level.
Okay,
I'm independently level. Like check those two all together. I have a question.
Can you compute this invariant for modified for spaces? Like for
winning points, the
best frequency.
For products,
I don't know. This environment, as it is defined, it depends on having the notion of a Fano index, so it's only in the Fano situation that you have it.
Yes, so far it depends very much ad hoc, right? Like
yeah.
The Fano index, you can make some definition that works for all of them. I'm not sure if it's right or not. You can look for the eagles. And then it's discriminant of this, half of the discriminant of this quadratic form, for example.
So you will have a definition which will work for non-Fano tree forms as well? Or?
Yeah, that's what I hope. There are various ways how you can get rid of this index. Just here it's written. When you speak about monodromy, that doesn't really know the index. The index here appears that if you have some higher index, then it's a pullback of some other family. That's why you don't have such a thing. By RSI covering, that's how. So the monodromy itself it kind of knows this.
Well, if there are no further questions, things are getting.